getting hotter with Conversations with Carlett. Thursdays at 9 a.m. If you missed it, you can always catch it again on Saturdays at 9 a.m. Girl is on fire. You're tuned into SA Radio. My name is Carlett Badenhorst, and this program is called Conversations with Carlett. But today, I've got someone incredible with me. I mean, if you love photography, then this is the guy to go to. So, hello, Francois Oosthuysen. How are you?
Hello, Carlett. I'm very well, thank you. How are you?
I'm great, man. I'm so excited to have you with us because we share something in common, and I want you to tell our listeners, what do we share? What's so precious and so awesome to us?
Well, photography is both of ours. It's a big passion for both of us. And I think that's where the connection lies. And every time we look at a photograph or discuss a photograph or see what's happening, and our eyes light up and we share the same emotion. So I think photography is exactly that.
Indeed, photography it is. It's actually incredible that photography is the science of light that we capture in a moment in time. And but I need to know, Francois, since when did your love for photography start? Where does this incredible journey started for you?
Well, Carlett, it actually started quite a while ago, still when film was the big thing. And I actually started my career with Canon. A film camera, and it was, I can't exactly tell you how long ago, but probably more than 20 years ago. And it started actually with wildlife. Wildlife is still one of my passions. And every time with our anniversary, my wife and I went to the Kruger National Park, and we took our tent and we camped out for a week. And I took photographs of animals, anything that moved, I tried to photograph. So at that stage, it was quite difficult because now digitally 3,000 photographs in a weekend is not a problem. But when you do film, 30 shots, I think at a time, you need a lot of film. So that's where it basically started. So probably about 20 years ago. And definitely wildlife.
20 years back when film was the king of photography. I mean, how many film did you had in your gearbox?
Yeah, no, I normally started out with one or two, but after the first time that we went there and I saw the diversity of what we can actually take photographs of, it quickly counted up to quite a number of rolls. So yes, quite a number.
Yeah, no, everything advanced. 20 years back, we are talking about film. And in 2021, we are doing digital photography. So a lot has changed throughout the years. So just quickly explain to me, how was your transition from the film to getting your first digital camera? And I assume, please help me when if I'm not correct on this one, you started with Canon. Are you still a Canon fan?
I am.
Okay.
I am, and I've been with Canon ever since. So my transition actually, I'm basically in the third generation of cameras. I've since moved to mirrorless cameras. So I did my stint with the SLRs. I started out with a 350D. I moved up to a 450D. And then when I earned a little bit more money, I could afford a 7D. And all of those cameras I still have. And then I moved to the mirrorless. I thought that was where the technology moved to. There was quite a number of things that I liked about it. And I bought the new R series, and I think last year I bought the R5 series, which is one of the better Canon cameras out there, and I can honestly say that it's absolutely brilliant.
Yeah, no, I'm a little bit jealous. I'm still doing the DSLR, so that's okay. You know, quickly explain to us, if you have this camera going to mirrorless and having the DSLRs, what is the difference between the two?
I think that there's quite a number of differences, technical differences between the two. But some of it is just newer technology. The sensors are upgraded and very, very good. Pixel size, if that's important to you, if you have to crop specifically maybe for wildlife, then the pixel size and the sensors are very, very big. The mirrorless that I'm currently using is, I think, a 48 megapixel camera. When we started, it was like a 5 or a 6 or an 8. So Wi-Fi capabilities, ease of use. It's just like a mini tablet at the back. You've got so many different settings and things that you can change. And it's lighter. It's smaller with the same power. So I think that it is a step in the right direction. There's still room for the SLR. You get very good cameras and you can use them for quite a long time. I just decided I'm gonna change.
Yeah, you need to go with the times as well. I'm stuck in between the second generation, which for me is perfectly okay. But yeah, I'm a little bit green on this side, but nonetheless, we will get there too, you know, eventually someday.
You can dream.
Yeah, we can all dream. So the genre that you are doing and what you love is definitely wildlife. We've heard it. So quickly explain to me, what kind of gear would a wildlife photographer have?
Yeah, I just want to help you there. I started off with wildlife. The current genre that I'm pursuing is portraits. So I've migrated from wildlife to portraits. Some of the people I photograph are wildlife in their own right. So, but I think that for wildlife specifically, it's still something that I love. You need something that's got a better than average frame rate so that you can take those action shots when the leopard jumps on the impala. You need a zoom lens of good quality. And you need some pixel size, I would say probably more than 15 or 18 megapixels so that you can crop, because a lot of these animals you can't get close to. And if you can't afford a very big lens, especially birds, it makes it very, very difficult to get the bird in the frame and still see what you've taken the photograph of.
Yeah, it's quite important to have a decent quality of resolutions going for you, because I'm not quite a wildlife photographer, but you know, when the opportunity arises, we actually take of everything and anything that breathes, you know. So for me, it's quite difficult. It feels like you need to have like an excellent skill to do this, but you've transitioned now from wildlife to portraits. So what would a portrait photographer have in their bag?
Well, most of the photographers, you can use a zoom lens like a 70-200, which is a good lens. Most of those lenses are 2.8 f-stop, but anything between 100 and I would say 50 millimeters is a good length to use for portraits. Below that, you get distortion. In the face, like a cell phone, the nose is big and the head is small. And if you like that type of thing, there's obviously room for it. And but for me personally, I use prime lenses. I use an 85 prime and a 50 prime.
Come, let's be honest, photography is not the cheapest of it all. I mean,
it's not.
You know, I just had a recent discussion with another photographer during last week, and we've decided that photography is a very expensive hobby, and we were thinking, would 4x4, would that be less expensive than doing photography? So what do you think, Francois?
That's a good question. I think that in both cases, you can go extreme. If you buy a Land Cruiser, you can 4x4 in luxury. If you buy an old Toyota Bucky with a diff lock, you can go driving off-road if you want to for much less. I think it's personal preference at the, and what you're going to do with the photographs afterwards. If it's just, for instance, in portrait photography, I think that there's a lot more technical things that you can look at. You don't always need the best equipment to make the nicest photographs. There's a lot of room just to get the technical side right, to see what to look for. You don't need to do studio stuff. You can do it outdoors. So you can keep the budget very, very low if you want to, but then you must know how to approach it and just do it correctly.
So, Francois, when we are coming back, we're quickly going for a song break, you know. And I've decided, because we are doing photography and this is our passion, I'm going to hit the music as well with some photograph music as well. So, after the song break, Francois is going to tell us a little bit more in depth. What would a typical day in a photographer would look like, and the gear, and maybe go through some tips and tricks on how to take a good photo, because that's what I always get is, Carlett, I just want a good photo. And come on, you can get a good photo and you can get a great photo. So after the break, Francois is going to share with us how to get transform your photos from a just ordinary good photo to a great photo. So you are going to listen to Def Leppard, the one and only, with the song called Photograph.
Yeah.
So we are back. It is SA Commuter Radio. I am Carlett Barenhorst, and this is Conversations with Carlett. Oh man, oh man, this is absolutely fantastic. I've got a professional photographer with me, and he's just sharing. I mean, if you are loving photography, if you just want to capture your moments in time, this is the place to be. I mean, mahala for free, absolute gratis. You're going to hear what we are going to go through, a photography short photography course, and what do you need to do from being an amateur to a professional, and what a typical day this should be. So Francois Oosthuysen is with me, and he's sharing his life as a photographer. So Francois, tell me quickly, I mean, you get different genres of photography, like journalistic photography and portraits and wildlife, as we've mentioned. But your favorite these days are portrait photography.
Yes, absolutely.
So quickly tell me, why portraits?
Well, I think portraits for me is actually a personal thing. It's, I love the connection. I love actually talking to people and interacting with them. And I think portraits are, well, what I love about it is it becomes personal. You become friends with a person. You basically look into their soul, because I'm a big eyes guy. I love taking photographs of models' eyes, and it's a major feature in all the photography that I do. So for me, I think it's that personal connection, and that gives me a kick. And then I love the actual Photoshop editing afterwards as well. I like the creative side of it as well, not just the actual taking of the photograph.
So Francois, let's go through this process. How would you do this? From the day, okay, or let's say a client phones you up, or a family member, or whoever says, okay, I want you to take portraits. How would your typical day be?
Okay. Yeah, I do basically two things. People ask me to do portraits for them, and I ask models if I can take photographs of them. So both of these I approach in basically the same manner. First of all, what is the idea? What do they want? Do they want glamour? Do they just want something for work? Do they want to feel good about themselves? Is there a specific theme? Some people do cosplay looking like a superhero. So there's different things that people want. And I did a lot of work with models that needed portfolio shots to go to New York, for instance. And they actually got there because of some of the photographs that I've taken. So that's a compliment to myself.
Oh, that's a plus.
But I think it depends on what the client wants. I don't really do social events like matric farewells or weddings or something like that. I like the one-on-one stuff where I meet the client and we have a 2-hour, 3-hour session, and then we discuss the photographs and we go. So to give you a background, I think planning is very, very important in all of these shoots. I think that if you come to a place and people ask you a whole bunch of questions, and you have to make decisions on how you're going to take it, what lighting you have to do, then it's going to be a rush job, and I don't think that you're going to be as good as what you can be. So for me, planning is predominantly the first thing that I do. So Pinterest is a very good board for ideas. So I ask the client, okay, first of all, what is it that you're interested in? And then we go look for ideas, and we compare notes, and I send some photographs to her or him, and he sends some, or she sends some stuff to me, and we compare notes. So what I then do is I try to mimic the vibe or the mood that is in the photograph. If there is color, lighting involved, what the light setup is to create the same type of lighting on the face. And then basically it's wardrobe after that. I don't have a wardrobe that the people can rent, or they normally bring it themselves. So next step is to actually ask them, what is it that you can bring? Do you have formal wear at home? Do you have, if the shoot is maybe like a winter look, how many jerseys can you bring, or scarves or mittens or something? So it basically depends on the shoot, obviously, what the wardrobe is going to be like. And then makeup. I've got a makeup artist, Jan Vereniging, that I use. She's extremely, extremely good at what she does. But obviously, you have to pay for that to come through. And for me to use, most of the models do their own makeup. But at the end of the day, you get what you pay for. If you use a professional, you do see it on the photographs. Yeah. Because of the camera equipment that I use, you can't hide a lot. So I hide in Photoshop, but in the camera, just as I take it, you can't hide much. Mm. So yeah, that's also something we discussed with the model. Is there something that she's not happy with that I have to take out or put in? And so basically it's about a 2 weeks concept planning before the actual day of the shoot. After that, I do my own preparation. I obviously look at what the client wants. In my mind, I go through the setup of the lights. If it's something that I propose, obviously I know what I want to do. And then at the day, we've got a studio that we use at the Klip River Country Estate.
Yes.
I do have a studio at my own house as well. But as far as equipment goes, if you want to do a studio shoot, I do have my own equipment, and then I go do the setup and wait for the client. And basically, yeah, then we start experimenting with the light to get the lighting correct, see if the client likes what she sees in the photographs, the preliminary photographs. And I am very excited every time I take photographs, so I must actually have a deadline to stop, otherwise I just continue. And that's probably a bad thing, because I don't always do it for money. I just continue, and I enjoy it, so that's what happens.
So
normally a session is about 3 or 4 hours, which is long. I know professional guys do like 1 hour or half an hour studio shoots. You can get a fair amount of photographs in a half an hour shoot. But I like to go through like 5 or 6 wardrobe changes, and just to get different photographs for the client. Otherwise, everything is just the same all the time.
So it's quite important to prep and have that communication line open, because on that day, you won't typically know, okay, so this is what we get, this is how we do it. And if there's sudden changes, it upsets the apple cart a little bit sometimes, or maybe a lot. It all depends on how many changes and shifts there would be, and if the client doesn't stick to what you've discussed. So it makes it sometimes just a little bit more difficult. But I think most of the times it's always on track and good to go, and I absolutely love the portraits that comes out. I've seen some of your portraits. I'm always amazed, Francois, how on earth did you get that? And I know it's time consuming, it's prepping, and it's a lot of things that's going on. It's not just clicking and then a press of the button and you go.
No, you're absolutely correct. I think that one of the worst things that a model can do when she goes for a shoot is not to prepare herself for the shoot. I mean, wash your hair, let somebody do your hair, do your makeup, make sure that you can get the best version out of you that is possible. And the other thing is, don't overdo it. I mean, if you come, I've seen some ladies that, I mean, it's so heavy on the makeup that it actually looks worse than what it probably should be, you know?
Yeah.
So don't overdo it. Keep it natural and keep it fun. I think if you, after like 2 or 3 hours of shooting and trying to look beautiful for the camera and you haven't enjoyed it, then you've wasted your time. And you can see it in the photographs, because a lot of these ladies don't have formal training. They're not full-time models or models or part-time models even. So what I also do is, and I think that something that I do well, is to coach the ladies how to pose. If you want to create a certain mood, what to do. If you want to, you can either look sexy, or you can look fun, or you can look serious, or that's all in the face and the attitude and the posture. So these things are all, anybody can basically do it. And it's my job as a photographer to do it the best to my ability so that you can be happy with the result.
Yeah, Francois, it's sometimes very difficult for a photographer if you are not using a professional model. And so to get something that you want and the client want, but in the end, it boils all down to creativity. And if you are comfortable and the client's comfortable, then I've noticed this, that you get incredible shots. But if the client's not comfortable, sometimes you can see it. You can definitely see it. You don't even sometimes have to have a trained eye to see it. It just pops up on the photograph, and then they say, but you're not a good photographer, and at the end it's not true.
No, I agree with you. I think that it's sometimes very difficult. I think in studio it's even worse, because if you haven't been in the studio environment, I think it is a bit difficult for you to relax, because there's all these lights. It's a backdrop. There's nothing natural about it. You sit there and your job is to look pretty and to connect with a photographer, and it's not always that easy. So I take my hat off to the ladies to even attempt something like that. So I try to do the best that I can to make it worth their while.
You know, Francois, sometimes now you're speaking of ladies, and sometimes you as a photographer needs photos, okay? So I don't know whether you were in the same position as I am, but I'm living alone, okay? So I don't have an extra pair of hands. So I will set my camera up, and then I have to be all alone in the studio. And do you know how awkward that is, to be in the front of the camera just to get a profile pic? I mean, there's sometimes that you need these things, you know, and then you have to create it yourself. And oh man, is that sometimes difficult? And you all alone. Now imagine, I can only imagine how you would feel if you're not doing this as a professional model. And
it is intimidating. But I think it's good. I mean, if you come out of your comfort zone, you learn a little bit more about yourself. And if the ladies want to attempt that, I mean, a lot of the clubs, photography clubs in South Africa, they do give open days where anybody can bring a model, or you can go and people will take photographs of you. And I think it's easier in a natural environment where you can walk around or lean against a tree or stand against the wall. It might be a little bit easier and more comfortable than actual studio. So if it's something that people want to do, I would suggest that they start out with outdoor shoots, that type of thing.
Yeah, well, speaking of outdoor shoots, I just love the outdoors. It's less complicated.
It's less complicated than it's more complicated. I can just, Carlett, if I can just elaborate on that. I think that people sometimes, that's where knowledge of your camera and your settings comes in, because you can very quickly destroy a photograph if you don't have any real plan in how you want to take it. If I take a photograph of a young lady standing with a tree behind her, if you use, for instance, I'm going to use a little bit of a technical jargon here. If you use not a narrow depth of field, all the leaves and everything will be in focus, and there's going to be such a lot of information on the photograph that you might miss the beautiful lady that's standing there. But if you know that you must use a narrow depth of field, that will all be blurred and the lady will stand out against, and it will make a better photograph. So just same person with the same background, just taken differently, will look differently. So you need some sort of, not training, but skills, and know what you do to get the best out of it.
No, you need to know that your subject matter is more important than the tree itself. So,
absolutely.
And I mean, we've seen it. Then the amateurs will come and have this lovely photo, but there's too much going on in the background, and you lose the quality of the emotion and the portrait itself than just having that beautiful model standing there at the tree and have the blur background, which looks absolutely stunning, opposed to have your depth of field like on F11, and you see all of the background and everything. So you just need to know that manual is the way to go, and you need to know how to use it. Because, I mean, it's like driving a car. A camera is like driving a car. You need to know your equipment. You need to know what you need and what and how it works to get the best out of your equipment. And some people say, no, this gets a little under my skin, because they would always tell me, oh, Carlett, your photos look so good. Your camera is a good camera.
Yeah, it must be the best camera ever.
And then it's like, no, don't give my camera the credit. We are here, you know. There's an operator that knows how to actually use the thing. So, and I think with you, Francois, it's the same. You encountered that same awkward situation where people say it's your camera, and then you want to murder this person. And knowing that you won't look very nice in orange jumpsuits, you know, so.
Yeah, no, I've heard that before. And then I always tell people, if they baked a nice cake and it's nice and it's sweet and you enjoy it, you don't tell the lady you must have a very nice oven. You tell her that it's a nice cake.
Yeah,
and in our case, they say you've got a nice camera. It's not you that actually baked the cake.
No, you.
Yeah. So yeah, it's a similar thing. But I think you've touched on a subject that's very close to my heart. There, you have to know your equipment. If there's any tip I can give you, that's probably one of the most important ones. Is you have to know your equipment, and you have to know how to structure the photograph. Otherwise, you can just use a cell phone. Which is also fine. You can use a cell phone these days. The cameras on the cell phone is very good. But you have to know how your camera works. You have to know what ISO is, what f-stop is, your aperture, and what the speed settings are of the camera. And those three, if you manipulate them, as you said, you use a camera and manual, you can do anything, and you can create any look you want. You can create any feel that you want. And you can place emphasis where you need to place the emphasis. I think that is important.
Yeah, that's quite important. You know what? I know that you started out with wildlife. So many moons back, I was walking also in the Kruger. You know, you've got the bird hides and you've got these massive cameras, these lenses. You know, it's the best equipment ever. And you cannot help yourself to go and admire the cameras and the lenses. I mean, you've been there as well. Don't tell me you haven't. I mean, every one of us just loves the nice stuff, you know.
It's absolutely like a car.
But then one thing that hits me straight between the eyes, that massive camera with this expensive lenses, expensive camera, tripod, what if you look at the settings, it's on auto. Then I'm thinking, why?
There's money, no brains.
So that is sometimes a little bit heartbroken for me to see those auto buttons and having this nice, nice cameras. I mean, expensive things. But you know what? You need to start somewhere, I guess. And auto is probably somewhere, I assume. So hopefully.
Yeah, it is. But it is. It should be avoided as quickly as possible, as soon as possible, because there's so much more to photography than letting the camera decide for you what you want to do with a photograph. So as an artist, you need to manipulate whatever you can.
No, photography is definitely capturing the light. That's if I'm not mistaken, that is some definition, give and take of what the photography is. It's the science of capturing light. So you need to know what lighting comes in and how to manipulate it with being on manual to actually get it. Your story out there, because I am all for storytelling. Yes. And that's a way of creating your atmosphere to tell, to capture your story at the end of the day. So you've heard it now from Francois that manual is the way to go.
Yeah, absolutely.
So, as we are talking about photographs, you know Ed Sheeran, or whatever the song called Photograph. So when we're coming back, we will hear from Francois a little bit of tips, what to avoid and what to embrace. So here's Ed Sheeran with Photograph.
Loving can hurt. Loving can hurt sometimes, but it's the only thing that I know. When it gets hard, you know it can get hard sometimes. It is the only thing that makes us feel alive. Keep this love in a photograph. We made these memories for ourselves, where our eyes are never closing, hearts are never broken, and time's forever frozen still. So you can keep me inside the pocket of your ripped jeans, holding me closer till our eyes meet. You won't never be alone. Wait for me to come home. Loving can heal. Loving can mend your soul. And it's the only thing that I know. No, I swear it will get easier. Every piece of you. And it's the only thing we take with us when we die. post back on 6th Street, hearing you whisper through the phone.
You're at the top of the mountain.
Yeah. This was Ed Sheeran with Photograph. Oh man, I'm just loving this conversation. I mean, capturing your memories, your incredible moments. Can this even get better? I know, yes, life can be better with a camera and coffee.
Yes, no, absolutely. I believe you've hit the nail on the head there. I also enjoy my coffee. And I think when you get something that makes you excited, even if you think about it 12 o'clock at night, then you know that you're in the right direction. So, and that's what photography does for me. I work during the day and I edit during the night or maybe in the mornings early. And that gives me my escape. It's my sanctuary. I love the editing part of it as well. We haven't touched on that yet, but it is something I put my music on, I listen to it, and I just submerge into this world with Photoshop and doing all these nice things to get the photograph better the way that I like it.
You know, you're quite right. We didn't even touch on... I mean, we all use Photoshop, or most of us, and Francois, I know you do. So that's an important program to have. Just sideline tip for everyone out there, Adobe Photoshop. So we'll give a shout out to them as well. So Francois, you've said you're an amateur in photography. Yes. Okay, but I mean, if I look at your photos, it's professionally done. But what makes you then an amateur and not a professional?
Yeah, Carlett, I think that it is, I think the biggest difference between the two is just the one asks money and the other one doesn't. I don't think at all that it's skill level. Maybe some people, professional people, will crucify me for that. But I know a lot of people that does unbelievable work in their private capacity, and they do it for free, or they just do it for themselves. And if you want to make a living out of it, then I think it's hard work and you have to process it and you approach it differently. I think if you're a professional person, you need to plan, you need to get the jobs in. There's a lot of work out there, but it's also a hell of a lot of competition. So your creativeness and the way that you approach it and your results will make you a successful professional person or not. And I think it's a difficult thing to do. I take my hat off to people that do it for a living. And I think that you need a bit of money and luck and experience to start and just go with it.
Yeah, Francois, sometimes, you know, and this is, I think you've seen it as well. Sometimes people just get for Christmas, you know, and I'm not being ugly or nasty or what, but some people don't have skill. They have the love of photography, but they don't know how. And then they do get a nice camera for Christmas or whichever, maybe a birthday, and now suddenly they a pro photographer. But they've got it, like you said, they missed it actually, because you're just an amateur enjoying photography. Not everyone can make a living out of it, and it is indeed hard work. I mean, sacrifices that you have to take, having to go to an event or being with family. Which one do you choose? Obviously, when you in the business, you go for the money, you chase the money, and the money needs to work for you. When you do it as an amateur, it's luxury time. You can do it whenever you want, how you want it, and it's fun times, actually. I sometimes wish that I could be in the amateur business, you know, where you can just relax and do it for the fun of it.
Yeah, no, I totally agree, Carlett. I think that once you do something as a job, there's pressure that comes with it. If you don't get it right, You don't put food on the table, where if you're an amateur, you can just do it for the love of it. And if you don't feel like editing today, you can stop for 2 months or 3 months and not do it and then start again, which if you do it professionally, you don't have that luxury.
Yeah, look, Francois, I'm going to be honest with you. Last week, no, from Sunday to Friday, from 6:30 to 10 at night, I was busy working on a job. Okay, that is hard work. That's really on your feet the whole day, thinking, processing, do this, do that. And it takes a lot of time and effort. When you are done for the day, you're done. Like, literally done. Kaput, klar. And when you do it for fun, I'm admiring the amateurs at this moment, because when last did I really do this for fun? You know, I'm always doing it for fun, and everyone's saying, let me just clarify this. Everyone says it's I'm always jawling around, which looks like it, but it's fun in the sun and I love what I'm doing, so it makes it worth it. But you need to have some, I wish sometimes you can get those luxurious times where you can just sit, take a photo, look at it, and process it, because that's not really what happens when you constantly being creative and do what you need to do. So there's definitely a difference.
Yeah, no, but that's why you have coffee, Carlett.
my friend coffee. For that.
I just want to comment on what you've just said there. I think that if you do it professionally, you do your hobby and what you love for other people. If you do it as an amateur, you do it for yourself. And I think that might be a big difference as well.
Oh, wow. That is a very nicely put, Francois. I've never thought about it in that sense, you know. So thank you. Thank you for that. It makes it so much, there's so much depth into that. Now, I want to know. Let's say I want to, I consider you as one of, in the club, let me clarify, it's not the club with the ka-ching, ching, ching music, it's a photography club, no? We need to go there. You as a professional and an amateur need to go to a photography club. Why?
Yes, I agree.
Yeah. Why would you say?
So, I think that there's a lot of value in a photography club. We both belong to Vereniging Photographic Society, which is the photographic club in Vereniging. It's one of the oldest clubs in South Africa with where photography is concerned. I think that the beauty of it is that you sit twice a month with like-minded people, people that share your passion for photography. And what I like about it is that everybody has got a different genre that they love, that they like, that they pursue. We've got abstract photographers. We've got photographers that do composite work. We've got photographers that travel a lot, that do a lot of travel photography. We've got photographers that do portraits like myself. We've got landscape photographers. We've got excellent landscape photographers in the club. And to get their perspectives on your photograph and to discuss it. And it's an experienced person that gives you advice, which is unbiased. He doesn't want your money. He doesn't need to tell you your stuff is good. And that is, I think, a massive benefit. People must certainly not be touchy when they come to a club. I think to the first time that your picture is shown on the big screen and people say, listen, this is not good, then you shouldn't go cry and run away and never come back. I think that is the other part of the club. It's constructive criticism. Some people don't like it, I know, and they're scared to enter. But criticism as such is there to build up, to show you where Your photograph is lacking. How can you improve it? What can you do? And if you listen to it, I mean, there's a lot of, we know a lot of people in our club that's gone from strength to strength, absolutely just blowing us away with the work that they do. And that's taken time, 2-3 years maybe, maybe less than that. And I think that's where the value lies. You come in, there's no real such mentorship with a specific person assigned to you, but the club as such has mentors or senior people in terms of photography experience that do help you and give you their opinion. And like myself, I like teaching as well. So I teach Photoshop courses. We've got practicals that we can show you how to use your camera. I know from the Bell Park, their photography club, they have an annual learnership with over, I think, 3 weekends where they teach you how to use your camera and what to do and how to take photographs and things like that.
You know, Francois, when you say it's like-minded people, you have to, I can't emphasize it more than to say you have to just attend the club. Like-minded people, like I said, it's like you need to learn. You can only learn with people together. You can't be an island all alone by your lonesome self and try to pursue your happiness or your photography. You just need to have the right kind of people.
And the right attitude. I think that if you go there and you see, because there are people that will take better photographs than you do. There are people that are more skilled in Photoshop than you are. But it doesn't mean that you cannot get to that level. And you might not want to get to that level. But it shouldn't be intimidating at all, because not everybody's competing on the same level all the time. And I think that, and it's also just nice to see what can be done.
You know what? It is always nice to look at someone else's work and think, wow, how did they do that? And then just afterwards, just go and ask them, how on earth did you get to
that?
Yeah,
it's as easy as that.
Yeah, and it's like you don't have to Google and be one perspective. It's like-minded people. But now, speaking of like-minded people, our time is running out, and I need to get tips from you. So shower me with wisdom here, Francois.
Okay. Well, I'm not sure how much time you've got, but I think that there's a couple of things that I think is crucial to young photographers or inexperienced photographers. I think the first thing, as we mentioned, is know your equipment. Know what buttons to press to manipulate the f-stop or the speed or the ISO. Know how to set your camera. Okay. The second thing is, don't worry too much about equipment, and this guy's got better equipment than I do. Focus on taking the photograph correctly. Thirdly, I think it's a basic thing, but get your subject in focus. It sounds easy, but there's very few people that actually do it properly. It's an important skill to learn, and you need to get it right every time, because then you've got 100% chance of using that photograph. And the other thing is a pet hate of mine, and I think that cell phones and selfies is a big contributor to that, and that's backgrounds. If you take a photograph of somebody and there's a white lawn chair at the back, people don't see it. But if you look at a photograph, then you cannot unsee it. It's the only thing that you see. So I think those things are, for me, very, very important tips to carry over to those that are just starting out with this.
Speaking on background, one of my it's just ugly. I don't even have any other decent words to say. When people are taking selfies in the bathroom, why? That's the only question I'm asking, why? But thank you so much, Francois. Sure. It's always such a privilege to just speak to like-minded people, and just, I mean, I was hanging on your lips literally all the time, because photography is just one of those things. Apart from coffee, I think it's first photography and then coffee. That's just me. And they need to work together. So the love of photography will always be one of the first ones. And it's so crucial to just share with like-minded people. So if you are listening, just go onto the website. I'm just inviting you now, Sommer, just because I can, to go to a like our photography club. I'm giving a shout out to Vereniging Photography Club. If you are close by, then go to that, or even in your own town. I think we've got how many photography clubs, Francois? A lot.
Yeah, there's a lot. I think it's more than probably 140 clubs throughout South Africa.
So probably wherever you are, you can join somewhere in your town or very close to. Go and join a club. Be with right-minded people and just do what you love. Capture those moments. You know, Jean Locke said that photography is the truth. You cannot hide from it. It is what it is. So let's capture those moments, those snippets in time. So thank you so much, Francois, for just giving us insight into this absolutely incredible topic of photography.
Yeah, thank you, Carlett. It's been fun. Thank you very much.
And therefore, let's go for our last song with Ringo Starr. And yes, you've guessed it. It is called Photograph. So enjoy this until we meet up again next week. Same time, same place.